The reason I think my PC would be a good fit for Fix or Flop is that it's an iBuyPower PC, owned it for about 2 years, and it was previously my sister's PC up until it was giving her problems such as randomly shutting off. We never really knew what the issue was, we thought it was because of a dust buildup, but turns out we were wrong. I took some time and opened the PC up, removing the RAM slot while... RAM slot, okay, I think he means the DIMM. While putting the RAM back in, it made a weird noise and was a struggle to put back in. However, the PC still would not turn on, so I decided to remove the BIOS for 3 to 4 minutes. I think he means BIOS battery, CMOS battery there. It turned on, but was on a black screen, and it kept saying DisplayPort, no signal. Till this day, I still never figured out the issue and would love your help. My little sister has been asking for a PC, and if I can get this fixed, I could surprise her with it. The specs are GTX 1650, 8 gigs of RAM, and Intel Core i3 9th gen. Please. It'll be a blessing if you can fix this. This here is that viewer's broken gaming PC, and yeah, she's definitely a more budget-friendly iBuyPower pre-built. For starters, an MATX motherboard, a very small one at that, in a mid-tower, that smells like iBuyPower. In all honesty, the CPU cooler also smells like iBuyPower, but for a Core i3, it's probably okay. And this power supply, oh my goodness, this definitely smells like iBuyPower. Jokes aside, this kind of corner cutting is pretty typical for companies like iBuyPower, CyberPower, there's a bunch of different Walmart brands and Best Buy brands that will all do this. They'll buy very cheap power supplies and throw them into these rigs, these pre-builts, because they know that a lot of folks who buy pre-builts aren't very computer savvy. They don't know what hardware is good, what hardware is not. And that's how they maximize profit and they keep their margins up. So hoping that it's not a power supply issue, because it's possible this kind of power supply would have taken other things with it if that were the case. I'm hoping it's not, but we'll find out in this video. Stay with me.
To get rid of that annoying Windows activation watermark, head on over to VIP SCD Key. Purchase a Windows 10 Pro OEM key for a fraction of the price of retail. Just use a secure payment method like PayPal, enter your product key into your PC settings window, and say bye-bye to the watermark. And be sure to use our offer code SKGS for a sweet discount.
Hey there, and welcome to Fix or Flop. If you're new, check out pertinent info in the video description. Just know that everything you see us do in these videos is done free of charge. So the troubleshooting itself, that labor, I don't charge for. I make money on the back end by, you know, filming these videos and throwing them up on YouTube and the like. The only other thing I want to mention is that if you live in or around Orlando, Florida, and you are having issues like this gentleman is here, maybe your system is turning on but not sending a signal to your monitor, or maybe it's just not turning on at all, submit a form. That link is near the top of this video's description. First things first, let's attempt to turn the system on. I'm not sure how far we're gonna get with this, but we do need a baseline. So power at the rear, power up front. We had power on for a split second and it turned immediately back off. I don't wanna attempt to power this back on over and over because this very well could be a power supply issue and I don't wanna risk damaging anything else. So, yeah, I think I'm gonna start with the power supply. It's not usually what I do, but I wanna rule this out up front and I might even just upgrade them just because, even if it's not the problem, because this does not look like a suitable unit for a gaming PC of any caliber. Oh yeah, that's not good. So hooked up to our PSU tester now and you can see pretty much fails across the board. Looks like we're only getting the 5-volt to work. I'm not sure why nothing else is responsive at all. That is super, super strange. What's also weird was that the system was willing to power on at the start, just for that split second, so I don't think it's totally dead. I think there's an internal short of some sort, and that's why it's cutting off. Maybe this unit is actually attempting to save the remaining components. An easy way to rule it out is with a separate power supply, which you can see we've now connected. I'm going to power it on this way, and it looks like it wants to post. And we don't have the RGBs lit up. I don't have any of the SSDs connected to this new unit, but I do have my portable monitor here. And we're just gonna see if we get a post. Sorry about the glare. I have a pretty good feeling about this. And if that's all it is, well then gosh darn it, that cheap power supply really was doing its job and it really was trying its best to save the remaining components. I thought for a second that we were gonna get a post. Oh no, we have. Sorry, I couldn't see it. So yeah, we have a post. It's like super faint, but that is a really good sign. So at this point, I want to check remaining wiring, just give it a once over. He mentioned that he was having trouble seating his RAM. It didn't sound like he was very familiar at all, frankly, with building PCs. So I'm gonna check that stuff, and then we're gonna upgrade his power supply. I think that, well, the replacement is definitely warranted. This unit looks cooked, but I was gonna probably upgrade them anyway because it's just so old. I think I have a really good solution as well. This here is the Apeer Power 12M from Be Quiet. This thing's a beast. It's only 750 watts, but they go up to, I believe, 1,000 or even higher. It's 80 plus gold certified, fully modular, and not very large, meaning it should fit in pretty much any mid tower out there. On it, you'll also find the latest connector supporting up to 600 watts for the latest graphics cards. AKA, you won't need something like this right here. We get multiple connectors spliced from the same. It's just as stupid. You just get one of these and you run this straight into your new card. You don't have to worry about any of that. It looks a lot cleaner as well. We won't need any of that for this viewer's rig, obviously, but you can always take this system and migrate it to a newer build down the line. I want to thank Be Quiet for being the product sponsor of this video. If you guys want to check out the Apeer Power 12M, be sure to do so via the link in the video description.
At this point, we're just looking at a power supply transplant, and again, crossing my fingers that that's all we have to actually worry about here.
So we're gonna slide in the new power supply, fan side down because he does have ventilation underneath this case. Gonna take care of some basic wiring, 8-pin EPS up top connected. And the 24 pin's good, we've got the 6-pin, we've got our drives connected behind this tray. And I did my best to route these cables in a way that I thought was clean, other than, you know, them just running across here. This was really the only other option. There's a bit of a cutout space behind the motherboard itself. And I think this looks a lot better. We do have a cluster of cables here that are exposed through the cutout, and there's not much else I can do with this case. It is rather limiting from a cable management perspective. We can go ahead and tuck these fan cables in a bit more. And yeah, I mean, I think it looks a bit better now, and hopefully it turns on. This is the moment of truth. And I think everything's been hooked up and I'm ready to power on. RGB is not working? Oh, I actually see what that is now.
A few moments later.
Oh no, it is working without this cable connected. I'm not sure what this is. It's like some kind of adapter. Oh, I hate these RGB cables. They are so annoying. There we go. Okay, so it looks good. Just press F1. I had to get my keyboard. Now I'm not entirely sure here, but I think we have an operating system on this drive. From what it sounds like, we should get into Windows. It does look like that's what's happening. We have both SATA drives connected. He has a 3.5-inch drive at the rear and also a 2.5-inch drive. I imagine the OS is on the 2.5-inch drive since that's a solid state unit, should be a bit faster. We are in recovery. It might be because he was resetting his system so much, maybe because we were resetting it, just trying to troubleshoot it.
12 o'clock midnight.
No, okay, doesn't look like we have one, so I'm gonna confirm that with the viewer off camera, and then we can wrap this one up. The biggest issue that we had, we've already overcome. It now turns on. All it needs to do is get that OS installed. I'm not sure if he's using Windows 10 or Windows 11 or heck, even Linux or something like that. Who knows? So that'll be up to him. Oh, you know what? I am glad I checked because it does actually look like we have Windows installed on the SSD. It's trying to boot into the hard disk drive, which might have happened when I might have swapped around the SATA cables, the SATA ports for each drive. So that might be why it's slightly confused. So let's go into the boot menu. Then we're gonna change the, yes, boot one option to, wait a minute. That's weird. Okay, yeah, we're gonna change this to that so that the ADATA SSD is on top. And then now it's up top there, boot option number one. And then we're just gonna save and exit. Hey, there we are. So that was a quick one. Boots right into, looks like Windows 11. That was already on the SSD. Now, between the clip that you just saw and this one, I actually had to hop back into the BIOS because we were still getting the can't find bootable media prompt, and I had to disable CSM. Sometimes enabling CSM allows the system to boot into the bootable volume. Sometimes disabling CSM does that. And I still haven't totally figured out why that's the case, why it's so finicky, but I'm just gonna leave it as is. It boots repetitively into Windows now, and that's a good thing. Now, I am rather curious, before we close this one out, I do wanna see if we notice anything obvious inside of this unit. This is one of those areas that you do not want to mess with if you do not know what you're doing. Make sure that you properly drain the capacitors in these units before opening them up if you want to get that deep into it. The reason why I don't like showing it is because, you know, people just copy without hearing that disclaimer, and you can genuinely hurt or kill yourself by messing with stuff in here. I don't, at first glance, see anything physically toast, so pretty much the same as the last few times we've had dead units. There's nothing burned, nothing exploded in there.
Another issue with these units in particular is that even if you take the board out, you've got a whole string of spaghetti noodles to deal with because this is a non-modular unit. You can see it's quite dusty in there as well. I'm not going to spend too much time looking at this. I was just hoping for anything obvious here. The fact that this power supply is so old, I mean, it means it's probably only worth about 10 or 15 bucks, maybe 20 at the most, new. And since this one's dead, I mean, it's good for scrap, and that's pretty much it. You want to use some pieces on here for donors. Yeah, I wouldn't go any further than that, though. So, a few takeaways, then. We had another disaster averted here. I mean, the fact that it was only the power supply that got taken out here is actually a really good thing. It means that the power supply did its job. Even that cheapo unit, that's what they're supposed to do. I just had a little less faith than I might have otherwise, just because it's such an older, dirtier, and cheaper unit, to be fair. This new unit should last him several years, comes with a really great warranty from Be Quiet as well, and will definitely give him a bit more breathing room for upgrades down the line, which he might entertain, or maybe his sister, if he said he's giving it to his sister. Maybe she'll entertain those upgrades later on. But this is a very healthy starter rig. It does need to be cleaned up quite a bit. We'll maybe take it outside and dust it before we drop it back off for him. But other than that, the rig works. It boots into Windows, and we don't have any other issues to worry about. Now, if you enjoyed watching this video, let me know by giving this one a thumbs up. That would be greatly appreciated. If you want to subscribe and you haven't already done so, do us a solid. Consider clicking that red button. Very much appreciated there as well. If you want to support us on Patreon, that link is below. Or if you just want to join our public Discord server, that is totally free of charge. You can either contribute and help others out who have issues with their rigs, or maybe ask your own questions if you're trying to troubleshoot yourself. There are a lot of really helpful folks in that Discord who might be able to help if you are one of those people. We have a lot of entries still in the queue. I'm trying to think. I think we have like 30 or so that were submitted in the last 2 weeks. So there will be many more episodes to come. And thank you so much for watching. Again, the reason why we're able to do what we do here is because of your viewership. That continued viewership means so much. And it allows us to make a very small impact here in the local Orlando, Florida area. So yeah, with that out of the way, I'm going to get out of here. Thanks again for watching. And thanks for learning with me.